In this video, I'm going to show you how to scan your Kubernetes cluster for vulnerabilities and keep your cluster secure, not just on day one, but day two and beyond. First, let's set the scene. Let's try just GitHub. Oh, an awesome list. I know. The landscape. Let's go to the landscape. Right. Where do I even begin? When it comes to Kubernetes tooling, the landscape doesn't have your back. There's too much noise. Working out the right tools for you is a lot of work, effort, pain, fear, FOMO. This is why we need more opinions in cloud native. To cut through the noise, it gives us a clear path to more sleep. At the end of this video, you will see a demo of Spectral Cloud where I turn on all of my day two security scanning operations with a toggle box. So before I show you how Palette automates all of this away for you, let's talk about the actual stack that we're going to be using. I wouldn't just pick random technologies from the CNC landscape, and you shouldn't either. Spectral Cloud have put a lot of effort in to consolidating on what is the industry standard, or at least as close as we're going to get, for day two operations and security scanning in 2026 and beyond. First up, we have KubeBench by Aqua Security. This is our foundation. It checks the cluster against the SIS benchmarks, which is basically the global rulebook, if one were to exist, for hardening Kubernetes. It's not scanning your cluster or looking at your cluster to find hackers and malicious activity. It's checking for bad hygiene. Have you left anonymous authentication on? I hope not. Is your etcd encryption configured correctly? It fucking better be. Essentially, this is the bar for putting a Kubernetes cluster online. KubeBench will make sure you hit it. I would choose KubeBench because it maps one-to-one with the audits that your compliance team, security team are actually doing themselves. It turns what is typically a 200-page PDF into a pass-fail checklist that you can work through to bring that conformance in line. Next, we move from setting the bar, preparing our defense, into our offensive position. For that, we're going to use KubeHunter. So while KubeBench looks at all your manifests and config files, KubeHunter acts like the red team inside of your network and your cluster, actively probing your cluster, hunting for open ports, exposed dashboards, and logic flaws that a static config check will probably miss. And of course, we use this because compliance doesn't always mean secure. You can do all the right things and pass your SIS benchmarks. But what if you still leave the keys in the back door? KubeHunter will help you find those back doors before anyone else does. Third, we have Sonobuoy. Now, this is the only official tool from the CNCF for conformance testing. It answers the simple but critical question. Is this actually a Kubernetes cluster? Now, you could argue if it looks like a cluster and quacks like a cluster, it may be a cluster. But actually, the CNCF has a very strong test suite of thousands of tests that ensure that your API behaves exactly how the official spec says it should. We rely on this because custom distros and heavily modified environments do break things. If Sonobuoy says you pass, you know your Helm charts, your operators, your CRDs will actually work. This gives you a guarantee of interoperability with the entire Kubernetes landscape. If a tool targets Kubernetes and your Kubernetes cluster passes, the tool will work in your cluster. As we layer on more and more and more and more operators, hopefully not to the extreme of OpenShift, this gives you confidence that those operators will function and do their job. Again, we want more sleep, not less. Finally, supply chain. I mean, I could sit here and talk about how important supply chain is in 2026. We've all read the postmortems for the many, many attacks in 2025 attacking our supply chain as we deliver software. For supply chain checks, we're going to use Syft and Grype from Anchore. All the previous tools I've just listed and discussed briefly protect our infrastructure, but these protect our workloads. Syft helps us generate a software bill of materials, an SBOM, an ingredient list of every library inside of your containers and applications. Grype then matches that list against the vulnerability databases to find CVEs. The Anchore stack is chosen because of its high fidelity. In a world where Log4j and supply chain attacks happen day and night, and every day and every night, you can't just secure the platform. You need to understand your code and the code it runs on top of. So we put all this together. We have the rulebook, KubeBench, the red team, KubeHunter, compliance and standards with Sonobuoy, and an x-ray look at our stack with Syft. What's next? I'm going to show you how to set all of this up in less than 10 minutes. Wish me luck. So here I have my Kubernetes cluster. This is just using a Docker desktop with the Google microservices demo deployed. So we want to run through the four tools that I listed earlier to see the security posture of this cluster. In order to do that, we will deploy at least at first two Kubernetes manifests, one for KubeBench and one for KubeHunter. So all we need to do is apply job KubeBench to the cluster. This creates a job which in turn creates a pod. We can grab the name of this and just run kubectl logs follow kubebench. Now, this will output via the logs all the information that you need to understand the pass and fail status for each of the checks or rules that it confirms against your cluster. If we just scroll to the bottom, we'll see that we have 62 pass, 12 fail, and 59 warning checks. If we scroll back to the top, we can start to see information on all the individual checks. If we look for our first warning, the first one is here, we can see here that the permissions on our CNI interface file are a little bit too permissive. Down here, we can see that anonymous auth argument is set to false, or is not set to false. And our first failure, I believe, is that we don't have the appropriate kubelet certificate authority argument configured. Now, this output is obviously rather verbose and not easy to understand, visualize, or build an action plan for right away. But there is a lot of information here with remediation steps, so you can work your way through it until you have much better security posture than we get by default with kubeadmin running on Docker desktop. Next, we need KubeHunter. And just like we did with Bench, we apply the manifest, we run get pods, we can get a pod ID, or we can auto-complete it, like so. Now this one may take a wee minute. So let's come back in just a moment. And done. Let's take a look at the output. Now it's worth knowing this only took around 12 seconds to run. We can see our single node, but seems to be coming through as two because of the two IP addresses. We can detect metrics server, the kubelet API, the API server. And as far as vulnerabilities go for what is happening in this cluster, we can see that lateral movement is available via arc poisoning. We can see here, we've got exposed interfaces. The API server is allowing discovery and some credential access via service accounts. Now this is actually not too bad, but please bear in mind, this is a kubeadmin cluster on Docker desktop. This is not fully representative of production. What you find could be a whole lot worse, or hopefully a whole lot better. All right, so the next step is we now want to take a look at all the images inside of our cluster and generate that SBOM. For me, I'm going to run this SBOM just file target. We'll take a look at it in just a second. But if we kick that off, it goes to the cluster using kube control, gets all the pods as JSON, filters through it, grabs all the images, and now it is doing its scan. So what that looks like is here, we run get pods, all namespaces, use JSON path, and then all we're doing is looping over that and running that against Syft. Syft will then just take a moment and give us a report about any vulnerabilities around our images and application workloads running in our cluster. And now it is done. Now, because this ran as a bash for loop, the results are again a little bit difficult to understand because we'd have to loop through every execution of it to see the output. So we're only going to focus on this last image, which was the shipping service from our deployment. We can see here that this actually loads the image and works out which packages are installed, which executables are available, and even analyzes, digests, and metadata of files in some locations to show us that we have Go 123.2, which has some CVEs. Some are high, some are medium, and some one is critical. If we scroll up and take a look at the recommendation service, this has three criticals, more highs, more mediums, and even a few low. So it's very important to understand these CVEs exist, because otherwise, how can you protect your workloads and your cluster from these that may or may not be vulnerable? So let's get straight to it. What does this look like in Palette? Well, a whole lot damn easier. Here I have my imported local cluster, the exact same cluster, into Spectral Cloud's Palette. We click on settings, cluster settings, schedule scans, boom, boom, boom. Job done. Now that wouldn't be a very good end to the video. So let's go into it in a little bit more detail. We can schedule these scans, but as this is an ephemeral cluster locally, I'm not going to bother to do that. I'm just going to click save. If we click on scan, we have our configuration, penetration, conformance, and SBOM scan. So the three we enabled and one that's always available if you want to run it. We'll click run, run, and configure. We'll use Syft and click go. And we'll be back to check on that when it's done. All right, so our scans have finished. And here we have the results of KubeBench. So we can see that our file permissions are also not restrictive enough. This is a common thing that we're going to see. But the Syst benchmarks are there to encourage best practice. And it's nice just to see a very simple pass, fail, and warn, much like we got on the CLI, but in a slightly easier to consume way. We can scroll down all of these. We can run these tests as we've seen on a schedule. We can have them run once a week, once a day, once a month, whatever helps you work towards that goal of having a secure cluster. You can also download these as a PDF, as I have done here. So you can even email it to all of your colleagues to let them know that they need to ship up their clusters. Next, we have the results of our KubeHunter scan. Again, we have PDF and CSV access. And lastly, we have the results of our SBOM that scans every single image in our cluster, allowing us to click on one and see an itinerary of all of the dependencies and the vulnerabilities that are available. So it's not that hard to run these scans against your cluster using CLI tooling, YAML manifests, and hidden apply. But if you're doing this at fleet scale across multiple clusters, you may want to consolidate it into a single approach like Spectral Cloud Pilot offers. However, it's not just the fact that they give us a nice web interface to browse these reports, share them with our team, and even expose them over CSV and PDF. They're also available via an API and kubectl, Kubernetes, custom resources. Let's see one more thing. Let's run kubectl-n and we'll select our cluster namespace. Now this is an imported cluster, so I have this weird cluster ID. Your namespace may be slightly different. We can request our audits like so. Now, what is audits? Well, we can run kubectl API resources and grep for audits. And we'll see that this is a Spectral Cloud custom resource for storing the results of their audit scans. If we run this again, we can get one individual audit. And let's just say we want to grab our KubeBench result. We can fetch that as JSON, like so. And underneath the status, results, KubeBench, scan report, worker, report data, we have all of the JSON information with the results from the scan. Meaning I can actually automate pulling this out on a regular interval with my scheduled scan and store the results in Slack, a database, S3, R2, Loki, whatever you want. This becomes something you could now graph in Grafana over time to see progress and regressions. If you don't want to do that via kubectl access, there's also a web API available too. You can use the base URL with V1 Spectral Clouds, cluster ID features, compliance scan, where you have access to the logs from KubeBench, KubeHunter, etc., etc., etc. So not only does Spectral and Palette allow us to do this at scale across a fleet of clusters, it gives us API access to the results, allowing us to bring them in to our workflows, our automation, and our automatic remediation, potentially. What you do with this power is up to you. I hope you enjoyed the second installment in our Kubernetes Day 2 operations, and thank you to our friends at Spectral Cloud for making this series happen. Go check out their website in the link below, and we'll see you next time. Have a great day.